Hi, good evening. Today we start a cycle of short lectures dedicated to the Italian civilization and literature that I have prepared for the ancient history and the ancient languages groups. This evening we will introduce the historical background which prepared the appearance of the Italian language during and after the fall of the Western Roman Empire in Italy. The first documents of the Italian language date from the 10th century of our age. This language appeared in a peninsula that had already seen an extraordinary production of important works of literary, historical and technical content. Works that had been written in a different language, Latin, employed for more than 15 centuries before the Italian language appeared. Latin had become even the lingua franca of an immense geographical area, including the Mediterranean, large parts of continental Europe, and of the Near East. Let us now ask ourselves whether we could today easily imagine that a language so consolidated, employed by a civilization more advanced than those surrounding it, could be eradicated so completely that the inhabitants of the same peninsula where Latin had always been spoken would become unable to read the documents and inscriptions of their ancestors. We have obviously to envisage a dramatic change affecting profoundly the lives of the people. This change was represented by the fall of the Western Roman Empire and by the harrowing consequences it had in Italy. The causes of the fall of the empire were several and they continue to be subject of incessant debates. Those causes were of political, economic, military, demographic and moral order. Among the political causes, there was the crisis of legitimation of the emperors due to their more and more frequent proclamation by the Praetorian Guards or by other units of the Roman army. By the end of the second century, the Roman emperors had increasingly become expression of military units whose support had been quite openly purchased with promises of money. Units which had been sometimes implicated in the assassination of the previous emperor. By the third century was already an age of crisis. During the 49 years between Severus Alexander and Diocletian, not less than 25 emperors ruled the empire, and only one of them died in his bed. Sometimes different legions proclaimed different emperors almost simultaneously, or proclaimed one when another was already in office. The competitors would then start a war and those wars damage the commerce, threaten the roads, impair the agricultural production and the delivery of supplies to the cities. Furthermore, those civil wars undermine the public finances and the monetary stability. The emperors had often the necessity to mine in order to fulfill the promises that they had made to the troops that supported them. On top of the assassination of Roman emperors, we have to consider the unsuccessful rebellions. There was obviously no way to deal with a potential usurper other than killing him together with most of his supporters. The books of the 4th century historian Ammianus Marcellinus give us a somber account of the anxiety generated by those power struggles that knew no boundaries and no mercy. The Roman system had always been based on clientelism. Everyone sought the protection of someone more powerful in the hope of obtaining advantages and appointments, but those vertical personal ties also meant that it was very easy to become entangled in the bloody settlements of the power struggles at the top of the society. Their fatal outcomes could easily extend to dozens of supporters and to their whole families. The Roman elites, including the intellectuals, became exposed to extreme risks and to a crippling uncertainty. Also, the spread of Christianism concurred to the decline of the empire. Two of its principles undermined the empire's organization: the negation of the divine nature of the emperor and the condemnation of slavery. For the purposes of this lecture, I should also mention the influence of Christianism on the Latin language in Italy. Christianism had been brought to Rome by immigrants who were in marginal position within the Roman society. Latin had been always spoken in a variety of ways, even within the same city. In ancient Rome, you could have instantly identified someone's social background by his use of the language. The first Christians had been diffident or hostile towards the language of the aristocrats who had persecuted them. So the early church encouraged the adoption of a form of Latin that was suited to communication with simple people. So Latin became gradually simpler. It lost syllabic quantity, then its diphthongs, then it gradually lost a few cases of its declensions, replaced by an increased use of prepositions, which are easier to use than the inflection of nouns. Furthermore, already early Imperial Rome, the language of the plebs employed a set of different words than the Latin of the elites. For instance, those new words had been sometimes initially diminutive forms, others had been originally employed as metaphors, others still were used because they were clearer or easier to inflex. Instead of the word auris for ear, the plebs used the word auricula from the diminutive auricula. Instead of caput for head, it used testa. Instead of os for mouth, it used bucca. Instead of ignis for fire, it used focus, and so on. All those words of the plebeian language will eventually form the basis of the Italian vocabulary. In Italian, those words will be further simplified by dropping consonantic endings, like the M of the Latin accusative, which was one of the last cases to survive. But let's now come back to the causes of the fall of the Western Roman Empire. One of the military causes was the acceptance of barbaric troops as allies in the hope that the Romans could always control them. Since long time, the empire had been far too widespread with respect to the limitation of terrestrial transportation during the ancient world. The Roman army had never been large with respect to the immense territories it controlled. It consisted always of about 30 legions, increasingly placed along the frontiers, and many of them on the Rhine and on the Danube, where they also did the recruiting. Furthermore, with the time, the legions were increasingly flanked by barbarian troops under their own commanders. Those were allies, but they could, under circumstances, rapidly turn into enemies. In the second half of the 4th century, the Visigoths in Eastern Europe were being displaced by the Huns. They obtained the permission to settle within the empire, but the corruption of the local Roman commanders ignited a rebellion which, in 378, culminated into the Battle of Adrianople. The Visigoths inflicted a disastrous defeat to the Romans. The emperor himself, Valens, was killed during the battle. Adrianople probably marked a turning point in the history of the Roman Empire. There had been lost battles before, even important ones, but the Roman society had always managed to gather the energy, the cohesion, to react, to recover, and to defeat the victorious enemy. This time it was no longer possible. The three leading components of the Roman society of the 4th century, the military, the aristocrats, and the church, could no longer found the cohesion needed to react. Only a few decades later, another Germanic general, Visigothic general, Alaric, who had supported the emperor against another rebellious general and felt that he had been unjustly treated with his troops by the Romans, invaded Italy and requesting certain payments to be made, and not finding satisfaction, he took Rome and plundered it. For the first time in eight centuries, Rome was plundered. This was in 410, in the year 410. This was a catastrophic event, and Rome would be plundered other times, even in a more catastrophic way. A few decades later, in the year 476, another barbarian general, Odoacer, deposed the adolescent emperor Romulus Augustus, who had been placed on the throne by his father, another rebellious general. Romulus Augustus would be the last emperor, the last Western emperor of the Roman Empire. Odoacer ruled as a king, practically, for a few years. But he made the mistake to engage in a conflict with the Eastern Empire. And the Eastern Emperor promised to the Ostrogothic king Theodoric that he would grant him power over Italy if he defeated Odoacer. So the Ostrogoths descended upon Italy, and in 493 they found themselves masters of the country and heirs of a civilization of which Theodoric understood the greatness. He tried to establish a continuity between the past and the present. His principle, the arms to the Germans, the laws to the Romans, sums up his wise political design, but this design failed. The Latins, the Goths were never assimilated into the Latin society, which continued to look with hope towards Constantinople. The Byzantine state, which continued to be called the Roman Empire, had become by then a different entity, unable and unwilling to revive Italy's glorious past. The Eastern Empire would last another millennium thanks to the impregnable position of its capital, guarded by formidable walls and by a powerful fleet. Theodoric died in 526, when nearly a decade later, finally, the Byzantines intervened in Italy, one of the darkest periods in the long history of the Italic peninsula started, that of the Gothic-Byzantine War, narrated by Procopius of Caesarea. The conflict raged between 535 and 553. Over one-third of the Italian population died, killed by the war, by famines, or by the pandemic known as the Justinian Plague. As the ancient society crumbled under the war, the new religion of Rome held. The Church had copied the organization of the Roman Empire. Instead of an emperor, it had a pope. Instead of prefects, it had bishops. Instead of provinces, it had dioceses. From the second half of the 4th century, the Christians would start to ban the ancient rites. In northern Africa, fanatic Christian monks raided the houses in search of idols and perpetrated acts of violence, like the destruction of the Serapeum and the lynching of Hypatia. Both occurred in Alexandria. A huge number of ancient literary masterworks perished, some of them intentionally destroyed, some of them simply neglected in those violent times. The Roman Empire had established an admirable continuity with the Greek civilization. Most of the Roman aristocrats could speak indifferently Latin or Greek. But this continuity of the classical culture ended together with the Western Empire. Much less than 10% of the text of the classical world would be saved, and those texts would really become known after the Middle Ages, when they were recovered by the Italian humanists. After the Gothic Wars, the Italian peninsula was a wasteland, with its cities in ruin, its population scattered and miserable. From then on, the various parts of Italy would face different destinies. Sicily would be eventually conquered by the Arabs, who established there a caliphate and ruled wisely until they were replaced by the Normans in the 11th century. In the north, a new Germanic population descended upon Italy. The Lombards had been originally based in the south of Scandinavia. Over the centuries, they had moved through northern and central Germany into Bohemia and Lower Austria, until, under the pressure of the Avars, in 569 they had crossed the Julian Alps under the command of their king Alboin and rapidly spread throughout the northern plains and taking the region which is called Lombardy, where they besieged Pavia and made it the capital of their territories. They penetrated deeply into the center and the south of Italy, where they founded the duchies of Spoleto and of Benevento, which would outlive the fall of the Lombard kingdom. The king of the Lombards ruled over dozens of turbulent dukes. It was a tribal society characterized by primitive justice based on judicial combats and on ordeals. It was also a violent society. Soon after the assassination of Alboin, the so-called rules of the dukes started a decade of anarchy, in which bands of marauders sweep the peninsula, killing, plundering, and destroying the very last remains of the Roman society, which had been based on a class of senators, landowners. The Lombard kingdom lasted over 200 years and ended with the descent of the Franks upon Italy. It is now time to deal briefly with the Franks, their extraordinary fate. These people, after whom the largest country of Western Europe would be named, had been originally a group of Germanic tribes that had penetrated the territory of Northern Gaul. They had been repelled by the Romans in the 5th century and had settled partly on the banks of the River Rhine, the Liguarian Franks, and partly further west on the Atlantic coast, the Salian Franks. We know the Franks from the history of Gregory of Tours, which shed some light on the darkest age of European history. The Franks were initially ruled by the Merovingians, a dynasty that expressed a series of weak kings who ruled by delegating decision to a so-called mayor of the palace, Latin maior domo. Those mayors of palace gathered with the time a lot of power, while the Merovingian kings were gradually relegated to ceremonial function. At a certain point, one of those mayors took the title of duke to underline his power. And his son, Charles Martel, accomplished extraordinary military feats by defeating other people and by stopping the Arab invasion of southern France in the Battle of Poitiers in the year 732. Charles Martel was also a mayor of palace, but practically he ruled already as a king. His son, Pepin the Younger, obtained the support of the Pope and forced the last Merovingian king into a monastery. As first king of the Carolingian dynasty, Pepin became the champion of the church, who was in need for support. The Roman church was then in conflict with the Lombards, followers of the Arian heresy, and was also engaged in a conflict with the Byzantine church, who was then dominated by the iconoclastic movement. Pepin led his troop to Italy twice to support the Pope. He defeated the Lombards and granted to the Roman church certain territories that would become the nucleus of the future papal states of Italy. The Franks became the only Catholics among the barbarian populations of Europe. And this was the reason behind their spectacular ascent in the European history. The son of Pepin the Younger, Charlemagne, also accomplished extraordinary feats. He carried out in a brutal way the conversion of the Saxons, annexing their territories to the Frankish kingdom. He stopped the Avars in the east, annexing Bavaria and Carinthia. Finally, in 774, he defeated the Lombards, he deposed their last king, Desiderium, and proclaimed himself Rex Francorum et Langobardorum. On the Christmas night of the year 799, the Pope incoronated Charles Reed, Emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. This act would widen the divide with the Eastern Empire, which could not look with indifference to the proclamation of a second emperor in Europe. It also widened the fracture between the Roman Church and the Eastern one. The years of the Carolingian Empire marked the zenith of the age known as the Carolingian Renaissance. It was a short but important phase of the European history because it combined in a single government Germanic and Latin components that constitute the political heart of Europe even today. The old Roman Empire centered around the Mediterranean was finally dead. Something entirely new was born in this place. It is now time to go back to our initial question, how the Italian language was born. Now we have all the information to answer that. We have said that the Latin language had gradually transformed into a simpler variety of Latin, which had nothing to do with the Latin of Caesar, of Caesar. This simpler Latin became also spoken by the new masters of Italy, which were mainly Germanic people, the Visigoths, shortly the Vandals, the heroes of Odoacer, the Ostrogoths, the Lombards, the Franks. All those warriors were illiterate, and the instruction in the Italian peninsula had, of course, collapsed. So they imitated, when needed, the language of the Latins, but they simplified it further. There was no way for them to know the correct spelling. So imagine a Germanic warrior making the simple request of bread to some Latin inhabitant. Couldn't have possibly used the correct Latin sentence, "Dami illum panem." He would have said something close to "Dami il pane," which is already Italian. So, this is a short, short pictures of what happened and how the Italian language formed. In the next lesson, we will go deeper into the society of the early Middle Age and examine feudalism. Thank you for your attention and good night.